Hi, my name is Sebastian Gweskin. I work on Apache Cloud Stack. I'm actually employed by Citrix, but I work exclusively on the open source version, which is in Apache. So that's really an introduction talk. I think there were some talks about Cloud Stack last year already at Cloudboard, but that's really an introduction. And when we talk about cloud, you know, of course, we have software as a service, platform as a service, and infrastructure. And here, you know, this is really an infrastructure track, so a YaaS track. And to be fair, there are lots of different solutions if you want to build a YaaS in your enterprise. So, of course, you know, we heard about OpenStack, Eucalyptus from, you started at the University of Santa Barbara, was actually the first one. OpenNebula in Europe, that we're going to hear about, was also pretty early in the game. Overt now that we hear about from Red Hat. Ganeti, there was a talk by Ganeti actually yesterday. I was checking and just the data point, it's 60,000 lines of Python and 6,000 lines of Haskell. So it's a more lightweight, but it's also trying to manage clusters of the end. And of course there's CloudStack, and that's what I'm going to talk about here. So building a YaaS, you know, the big challenge with building a YaaS is that it's not out of the box. So we wish it would be out of the box and that we do configure, make install, and you would have your cloud and so on, but it's not that simple. You need a form of hypervisors, so already you have your sysadmins involved, you need to install all the, you need to configure all those machines, have the hypervisor, make the choice of hypervisor and so on. And of course you need storage to store the images, the disk images, you need storage to have all your snapshots, all the data volumes for the users and so on. And then you need a flexible network, and probably the networking is the toughest part in building a cloud. So you need those three components really, and you need to build that. In the case of public cloud, you're trying to isolate your users of your cloud, or even private if you want to isolate people from your enterprise, from each other. You need to you know, take all of this and build this in a multi-tenant environment. So we wish it would be out of the box, but it's not that easy. And it takes lots of people. Of course, you need to engage your networking guys, you need to engage your sysadmin and your developers, plus security if you want to convince your CIO that all of this is secure. So what is CloudStack? Well, CloudStack is really an open source infrastructure as a service solution, YaaS solution. And I like to put it in as a programmable data center orchestrator, because cloud is, you know, there's too much buzz, and YaaS, you know, it's also very buzzy, and lots of people talk about different layers of AAS and so on. So, you know, I took that from VMware that is starting to talk about software-defined data centers. So what we want really is to automate the management of the data center, and almost build some intelligence in your data center and in your operation. So whatever you build, of course, is going to expose an API, and then you bring in your developers that it can use that API to reconfigure everything and bring automation. CloudStack is hypervisor agnostic. We also have bare metal. It was just merged a week ago, I think. Scalable storage. We now have things like Ceph, React CS, React being probably know Basho, the company, so it's an object store from them that's pretty successful right now. And then we support complex enterprise networking, VLANs, virtual private cloud, load balancing, firewall, and so on. And the key design issue, really from the start in CloudStack, was multi-tenancy, was isolate users from each other. Of course, CloudStack is now part of the Apache Software Foundation. So it was donated by Citrix in April 2012, so it's been 8 months that we are there. So we are still in incubation, I mean, we are in incubation, still in incubation, doing well, but we'll see when we get out of incubation. You know, I'm sure you all know about the Apache Software Foundation. That was really, you know, the first and the leading open source foundation out there with HTTP. Of course, we all know tools like Ant and Maven and Spam Assassin and so on. What's interesting that we've seen these days in SF is that there's more and more cloud-like software, especially on the data side. So Hadoop, used by Facebook and developed by Yahoo originally, and then all the Hadoop ecosystem, HDFS ecosystem, edge base, MapReduce, and so on. You also have document store like CouchDB. One of our mentors is from CouchDB. And things like Delta Cloud given by Red Hat, Delta Cloud being really a driver to talk to different cloud providers. So we see all those software, and now FastStack is pretty happy to be in, you know, in that company with well-established projects, especially well-used and well-known in the enterprise. So the Apache way and the way that the, you know, all the people involving FastStack really approach the development of this open source software, you know, it's known as Apache Web, transparency, consensus, non-affiliation. So that means that, of course, you work for a company, somebody is paying your paycheck, but, you know, it's really the individual that matters in Apache. So it's a community of individuals. Respect for developers, of course, and meritocracy. What's good is that we didn't have to work on, you know, any of the processes of how the foundation and how the development of the software is going to work, because we had all those great projects that were there that developed those processes and hardened them out. So it's 100% committee driven. Everything is decided on the mailing list. You know, actions are taken on the mailing list, votes are taken on the mailing list. And the project is led by a PMC, Project Management Committee. Of course, there is a clear path if you want to participate in FastStack. There's a clear path from being a non-committer, submitting patches, and then, you know, becoming committer and potentially, you know, going up in the PMC, the technical leadership. Actually, it's not really a technical leadership because, you know, a non-committer could show some technical leadership and then, you know, graduate. So the Apache processes here are some snapshots about, you know, how it works and everything happening on the mailing list. A little bit of warning, it's a high traffic. Just this January, we had 5,000 emails on the dev and user mailing list, I mean, combined. So if you register, you know, be ready to get a pretty good stream of emails and get your filters going early. So we have emails where we graduate people, we invite people to be committer. I just became committer around Christmas. Here we have emails where people join the PMC, the management committee, and then we vote on the release, of course. So people can say plus one on releases, or they can actually put a veto on the release if they don't like things like upgrade scripts or things like this. So what has the move to SF done to FastStack? So FastStack was actually open source before being donated by Citrix to the SF. So what you see here is, you know, a graph of time, so February 2011 to end of December 12. In red, that's the mailing list of FastStack, the developer and the user mailing list before moving to Apache. So you see that's an accumulation, okay, of contributors. So roughly 100 contributors on both lists. And then when we move to Apache, we see a huge spike and a dramatic increase in the growth of the community. So right now we're closing in on 400 contributors on FastStack. Same thing on the user list, but it would seem that they overlap. There's roughly a 40% overlap, so that makes the entire community on those two lists at 600 people. And who's contributing? That's actually a no-no from an ASF standpoint because everybody is an individual, so I shouldn't be talking about the company that they work for because they contribute as themselves, not as their company. But we have lots of people involved, and here are a few ones. I'm putting SendGuard. It's not a very well-known company, but they do disaster recovery originally for physical offices, but now for IT. And our release manager, Chip Childers, is from SendGuard. Sugar Phyllis, that's NPC Extreme. Those are two companies in the Netherlands, in Amsterdam, and those are two guys who are big contributors. They've done the VCR integration and the Ceph integration. They're in Europe. Big Switch is now sending patches for integrating the Big Switch SDN solution. In there, GoDaddy helped us at the beginning with the move to Maven, Karingo as an object store. ListWeb is also a cloud provider in Europe. So let's talk about a little bit about the internals here. And as I said, you know, in NES, you have those three parts, compute, storage, network. I guess if you know OpenStack, that would be Nova, Cinder, and Quantum. Roughly. And you know, on the compute side, we're hypervisor agnostic, so you pick ZenServer, VMware, Oracle VM, KVM, and Bare Metal. Bare Metal was in an earlier version of CloudStack, and it just got merged for the 4.1 release, so we'll have that, which is basically, you know, Pixie Boot and Kickstart going through the CloudStack API. On the storage side, we have two types of storage. We have the storage for the image catalog that contains all the images. That's what we call secondary storage. And when an image is instantiated, basically the image is fetched from that catalog, moved into what we call primary storage, and then the instance is running from there. If you take snapshots, it goes in primary storage and then is automatically copied back to secondary storage. And we support different types of protocols, you know, local storage, iSCSI, you name it, Ceph now, React CS, all the object stores, and so on. And in networking, we have lots of different networking features. Networking in CloudStack actually is extremely powerful, and since it's so powerful, I'd say that it's a little bit hard to grasp at the beginning the way it works. But we do, you know, load balancing with HA proxy, firewall, VLAN, VPN, and so on. Probably one of the things to keep in mind with CloudStack is that it's a Java application. Okay, it's not Python. It's not C++ like OpenNebula with a mix of Ruby and Bash. It's really a Java application. Most developers use, you know, Eclipse and all the familiar Java tools to work with it. Runs with Tomcat, the API with Axis, and the build is with Maven. So all of you who are very familiar with you know, Java build system and Java development and debugging, you'll feel at home with CloudStack. In terms of releases, we released the first Apache, you know, when we've been under Apache since April. So we did the first release in November. That's CloudStack 4.0. We are working on time-based releases, so every 4 months, roughly. That's the idea, and we're still, you know, working on it, obviously. And we rather sleep on putting in a feature in the release than actually sleep on the date. Okay. So 4.1 is planned for March 22nd. Feature freeze was 2 days ago, was Friday. Sorry, and so that means that you can expect 4.2 in July. So really, you know, we're working on time-based releases every 4 months. And of course, we're still new at this, so you know, that's our goal. CloudStack cloud architecture. There's a little bit of a taxonomy to learn when you start with CloudStack. We have a management server. That's the core. That's where everything happens. And then we define things in pods, or first in zones. So yeah, that's like your availability zone in Amazon. And then you define pods, which are racks. Within racks, you have clusters. Even though a cluster may actually span an entire rack. And then you have your secondary storage for the image catalog, primary storage. On a cluster basis, that means that you can actually mix hypervisors within a single rack. You could have VMware, KVM, Zen on the same rack, different storage associated with them, and migrate within the clusters. The messy picture, you know, I'll clean that picture. We basically have a central management server backed by MySQL. It exposes an API with different roles, whether you are admin or a user and so on. We have a mapping from EC2 API to our native CloudStack API. And on the back end, well, we have different protocols to talk to the hypervisor. So Zen, we're going to talk XAPI, VMware, we talk directly to vCenter. And for KVM, we have our own little Java agent going. What's interesting is that we talk to hardware devices. So if you have existing hardware devices in your network, Juniper, F5, and Netscaler, Cisco, we're merging that soon. Or it has been merged, probably. We talk directly to those APIs to manage load balancing, firewall, and things like this. So you can integrate physical devices in your network. We have those little things here to help us orchestrate everything. Those are called system VMs. Console proxy is just a reverse proxy for VNC session. Secondary storage, that's what helps us manage all the volumes and moving the disk to the proper host and things like this. And then router, that's what contains, you know, HF proxy, DHCP, DNS services. And you can stop one router per guest network, okay? So one user is gonna have actually its own DHCP, DNS, and so on. And you can, you know, switch all those services off as you want. The networking, the key to understand about networking is that, you know, the assumption was multi-tenancy. So we wanted to isolate users in the concept of, you know, thinking about a public cloud, but actually even in private clouds, we see enterprise wanting to isolate different departments, different groups, you know, properly using VLAN. So we have two types of network. We have basic networking, advanced networking. Basic is a shared layer 2 for everybody. So, you know, the people potentially, you know, sniff their own packets and so on, but we set up isolation using security groups. So the Amazon security groups that you all know and love. So that's in the basic networking side. On the advanced networking, that's where we do VLANs. So you need to pre-configure VLANs on your network, and then CloudStack is just basically going to lease those VLANs and allocate them to different guest networks. So those are the two things to keep in mind. Of course, SDN is big. Software-defined networking is coming up. It's supposed to help with lots of things. I mean, Google uses SDN to optimize their network. You can use it for load balancing or firewall potentially if it scales. But what we're doing it, what we're using SDN for is really isolation types. So as I said, to isolate all your tenants, you know, the basic mode is to use VLANs, but VLANs may not scale, you know, 12 bits, and again, it may not be supported by your switches. So you could run out of VLANs very quickly. So what we've done is that we have a native SDN solution in CloudStack with GRE. GRE is a protocol to tunnel between the virtual switches. So we build a mesh of GRE tunnels in your data center, and that allows us to remove that limitation on VLANs and still isolate the users. Another type of tunneling is STT. And what the STT isolation, how the STT isolation is implemented is with the Lysira. So Hugo Trippers from Schubert-Phillips in Amsterdam that I mentioned earlier is the one who contributed the plugin to integrate with Lysira. So if you're running Lysira, of course that's proprietary software, if you're running your Lysira private gateway in your data center, you can integrate with CloudStack, and that's going to build those meshes of STTs to isolate users. Originally, it just did it at the L2 layer, but now in 4.1, we're also going to be able to do L3 routing with it. The native solution, that's GRE, and there's a difference in the protocols, and that brings a difference in bandwidth, especially between virtual machines. So STT is as much better performance than GRE, even though at one point, you know, this may go away. This is a picture stolen from Big Switch website. This is now in the 4.1 branch, so you should have it in March and the end of March. That means that if you have open flow switches from Big Switch or somebody else, you should be able to use the SDN integration directly with OpenFlow. OpenFlow being the protocol used by the controller to send new flows onto the switches, those switches being the virtual switches on the host, and implemented with the OVS, the OpenV switch. On the storage side, as I said, we have primary and secondary storage, and depending on the type, we support different things. Secondary storage is really, you have to think about an object store. That's where we put the image and we get the image. So object stores are good for this. OpenStack Swift can be used. We have things also like Karingo, proprietary solution, but it's integrated if you have a Karingo object store. We're gonna see more native S3 integration in there. Right now, we still have to do a little bit of bootstrapping to put your object store in there. But you know, this summer we should have totally native S3 interface for the secondary storage. Primary storage, you know, cluster LVM, iSCSI, local storage, and then, you know, Ceph, which has been integrated. The integration of Ceph is probably the, you know, the coolest thing these days, because Ceph allows you to chunk your KVM images across the nodes in your Ceph cluster, and that gives you a pretty good throughput. And then Basho has a pretty cool object store that's integrated. So those two from the storage side, those two are the very nice features going on. So once you've deployed that cluster, you have that final hypervisor, you have that storage in place, and then you have figured out your networking setup, you know, you have your cloud running, so now how do you use it? There is a powerful UI that comes with it, has always been there. That UI basically talks directly to the API, and this is just, you know, front end. You can manage your image catalog, templates, start instances, create different types of network offering, configure the cloud. You can do everything, almost everything through the UI. Sometimes a feature is developed that you directly use the API to use it, and then the integration in the UI comes later. The API is very extensive. That's just a snapshot. There's roughly over 200 methods in the API. It's not a pure REST. It's really just Java methods dropped into access that you call over HTTP, HTTPS, access key, secret key that you all know, and then come up with a signature. What's interesting is that you can manage the network with it. So security groups here, you can manage the router, manage firewall, of course, add host, add storage pools. So all the methods are in there to basically do and configure your entire cloud. This API is not a standard, of course, it's our native, you know, API. We could have it all day on cloud standards, but you can turn on an EC2 and an S3 mapping directly in the UI or via an API call, and that's basically going to run a second Tomcat application that maps EC2 calls to our native API. Yeah, EC2 is not a standard, de facto standard, but not official standard. We're hoping to find, you know, people who are willing to do a data cloud driver for cloud stack, so that we can get the CME front end in there. Yeah. If you want to get started, we have a sandbox called DevCloud. That's a virtual box image. Put it on your machine, launch it, and you're gonna have a fully configured cloud stack instance. So what that means, okay, is that you have a VirtualBox instance running. Inside that, you have the management server running, Java application. We have set up MySQL. We have those little system VMs, tiny Debian squeeze appliances running. And then what you're gonna do is launch TTY Linux instances within the VirtualBox, okay? So this is just for play, this is for development, and this is definitely not intended for production or anything. This is just to, you know, get your feet wet and see how cloud stack looks like and get started. If you're interested in the development, you know, what you can do is actually take that sandbox and run the management server directly on your machine. It's a Java app, it's gonna run on your laptop just fine. Set up MySQL, and then basically, you know, you have the management server running there, and you're going to use that virtual box instance as a host, okay, just as a hypervisor. So that's just an idea to get started. In the abstract, I said I would talk about CloudMonkey, but I just don't have time. CloudMonkey is our command line interface. One thing that I loved about OpenNebula was that they have a very powerful command line interface. So for admins, operators, it's very nice. You know, they're familiar with their shell. They can use the cloud like that. So what we did in CloudStack, we also now provide a command line interface we call CloudMonkey. It's a little Python. There is some Python, a little bit of Python in CloudStack. Thank God for me, because I'm not a Java developer, so I like the Python. But basically, CloudMonkey is there, and it gives you a very powerful CLI. We run events through a site that we call buildacloud.org. You can follow us on Twitter and follow me, Seth Goa. I'm in Europe, and you know, I'm looking to develop a community around CloudStack. So if you're interested, you know, let me know. We're going to try to, you know, run more workshops so people can learn about it. to Amsterdam, we'll go to Scotland, Berlin, Brussels, back to Brussels this summer, and then the XCOM Europe and OWF in the fall. If you're interested, just grab me and we can talk about it. The website, cloudstack.org, if you just remember one thing, it actually redirects to Apache infrastructure website, incubator, apache.org, cloudstack, Twitter, all the slides on SlideShare, cloudstack, and we have lots of very good videos. If you want more details about cloudstack, we had a collaboration conference in Vegas, and all the videos have been put on YouTube. So youtube.com, DYI Cloud Computing, you'll find all the guys participating in cloudstack giving their talks. Thank you very much.